Hi, my name is Samuel Barron. When it comes to future work, one of the areas that we like to do more research on is olive oil. We started off the year making olive oil one of our main samples, but since there were too many variations in our peaks, we couldn't use them in our study. These variations were mostly due to the fact that most of our samples were made at the beginning of the year before we perfected our synthesis method and our integration skills on the gas chromatograph. Another study that we would like to do more research on is the different health benefits between wild salmon and farm-raised salmon. We've read many articles this year talking about that wild-raised salmon is better than farm-raised salmon because wild salmon consume mostly omega-3 fatty acids, while farm-raised salmon can consume mostly omega-6 fatty acids. Therefore, we'd like to do some actual research by injecting samples into our gas chromatograph and see if our results line up with the hypothesis that we were seeing in the article. An additional study that we would like to do more research on is the difference between grass-fed beef and corn-fed beef. We also read many articles stating how grass-fed beef is better than corn-fed beef because grass-fed beef contains mostly omega-3 fatty acids, while corn-fed beef contains mostly omega-6 fatty acids, which leads to more racidomic acid in the body and therefore more inflammation. We tried to experiment on this at the beginning of the year, but since our room was not equipped for the necessary use of chloroform, we couldn't continue this experiment. The last thing that we'd like to do more research on is investigating to see how the double bond placement and the structure of the fatty acid affects its health benefits. For example, an alpha-linolenic acid and gamma-linolenic acid, they're both carbon-18-3 fatty acids, but alpha-linolenic acid is better because it's omega-3 fatty acid, while gamma-linolenic is an omega-6 fatty acid. Therefore, we'd like to see how the double bond placement affects all types of fatty acid structures.
Hi, I'm Alyssa Lederman. This presentation is about the association between gut microbiome, disease, diet, and inflammation. Microbiomes, or microbiota, are microorganisms. I did a meta-analysis of microbiomes from 5 different medical articles and learned that the gut microbiome is associated with autism. And further research showed an association with autism severity. We decided to look at the gut microbiome's association with other diseases and its association with diet, inflammation, and development. We saw that there was a connection between microbiomes and the brain. Research shows that the gut and the brain communicate through the enteric nervous system. Furthermore, enteric microbes can communicate with the brain. Many studies show that behavior is linked to the microbiomes in the gut, suggesting that microbiota imbalances may be linked to neurological disturbances. In one study, germ-free mice displayed stressed and anxious behavior, unlike the mice who were free of certain pathogens. Colonizing the germ-free mice with the feces of specific pathogen-free mice normalized the behavior of the mice to a degree, but colonization with probiotics completely normalized behavior. Also, early intervention in stabilizing the microbiome proved to normalize behavior. Late intervention did not normalize behavior. We also saw that there was a connection between the microbiome and the immune system. The immune system is connected to the gut by lymphoid tissue, whose cells detect microbial changes in the gut through specific gastrointestinal cells and receptors. Gastrointestinal cells activate the inflammatory response when they detect pathogens. The communication between these cells, along with macrophages, lymphocytes, and the microbiome, regulates cytokine production. Diet and antibiotics have been shown to be associated with microbiomes in the gut, but the cause-effect relationship is unclear for diet. Microbiomes in the gut produce trimethylamine and oxide from L-carnitine in red meat and lecithin in egg yolk. Trimethylamine and oxide enhances the factors associated with heart attack, stroke, and death. Antibiotic use has shown some negative effects, especially for young children. Early life exposure to antibiotics affects the long-term development of adipose tissue, lean muscle, and bone, increasing adiposity and hormone levels related to metabolism. Probiotics have shown promise as a replacement for antibiotics. Some probiotics have been able to kill harmful bacteria, such as Lactobacillus cerevisiae, killing Listeria monocytogenes. Gut microbiomes can play a role in keeping the body in a healthy state. However, some microbiomes can damage the body. Some species of bacteria have been found to be associated with metabolic syndrome, either positively or negatively. Helicobacter pylori, for example, is associated with cancer and ulcers in the stomach. Various microbial compositions are associated with obesity, liver fat development, food allergies, and more. As an example, early colonization of Clostridium difficile increased the risk for yeast, allergies, and eczema. Since we can see that there is an association between microbiota, diet, disease, and inflammation, we want to do further studies to prove a relationship exists. We want to know, what is the relationship between microbiome, diet, and disease or inflammation? Do diets cause certain microbiomes to flourish, thereby causing disease through the risk, through the kickstart of inflammation? Or do the microbiomes in the gut tell the brain what they need and cause diets that cause inflammation?
Hi, my name is Catherine Doe, and I did research on antioxidants, which you can check out in Caroline Goh's video right above here. I also helped produce this video and co-direct it. I hope you guys found this video very interesting and informing at the same time. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and share this with anyone out there who you find that could find this very helpful. Bye!